Third is non-feasance. Non-feasance means not doing a, omitting to do a particular act which a person is expected to do. So wrong is caused. In, you know, thought is a civil wrong. So a wrong is caused in under the law of thought. But because of the malfeasance, misfeasance or non-feasance act of somebody, a wrong is caused. Today, to a person who is entitled to claim damages under the law of thought. So that's why, in other words, in every thought, there is either malfeasance, misfeasance, or non-feasance. Malfeasance means doing an unlawful act. Misfeasance means doing a lawful act, but in an improper manner. This is non-feasance means omission to do a particular act. So, when misfeasance, in every misfeasance, there is negligence. That is, a lawful act is done in an improper manner. Because of negligence, that act was done, and thereby some injury is caused to another. And as such, the person who does that misfeasance, that is, in lawful act in an improper manner, is liable under the law of tort. You know, that is negligence. In every misfeasance, there is negligence. Every misfeasance, there may be negligence. What is negligence? Failure of duty to take care. As an ordinary man, ordinary prudent man, is expected to take in a particular situation. For an example, X drives his motor car at a speed of 80 kilometers per hour on a highway when there is empty highway. The road was empty. But in the same speed, if he drives his car in a busy locality, in a busy town or inside Bhubaneswar city, certainly then he is negligent. So a particular act may be negligent in a particular situation, may not be negligent in another situation. So it is a failure of duty to take care. Law expects a person that when he does some act, or when he does some lawful act, he must perform that act with due care and attention. And in spite of his due care and attention, if some harm is caused for a lawful act he is doing, for that he is not liable for damages, not liable under the law of tort. So the negligence, in other words, that is failure of duty to take care in performing a particular act, as a reasonable man, as an ordinary prudent man, would have taken. But what the law expects, what is expected from an ordinary prudent man to act with proper due care and attention, such type of care and attention must be taken. If any lacking of it, then if harm is caused, then he is liable under the law of tort. That is, so very important. But in case of criminal negligence, it is a higher degree of negligence. There is some amount of mental element is there, rashness, recklessness. That is criminal negligence. For that, action can be taken both under the civil law, that is under tort, as well as under criminal law, for punishment for a particular negligence. When that negligence is a criminal negligence. Say, for example, for rash and negligent driving, causing hurt, that is causing death of person, section 304A of the IPC, there is provision for punishment. Because here negligence is a higher degree of negligence. There are some recklessness is there, rashness is there. But similarly, for that he is liable, the person is also liable under the law of tort to pay compensation to the dependent of the deceased whose death he causes due to his rash or negligent act of driving. So you should know the negligence, because the standard of proof in civil case, civil dispute, and in a criminal case is different. You know that in a to hold a person liable under the criminal law, that the allegations against him must be proved beyond all reasonable doubt. But for to make a person liable under the civil law, the allegations are to be proved as preponderance of probability. That means to which side more evidence is there, that it you accept. So that is why the in this context, the leading case, Indian leading case, is Jacob Mathew versus State of Punjab. Jacob Mathew versus State of Punjab. In this case, the Honorable Apex Court has distinguished what is the difference between criminal negligence and civil negligence. So what the Honorable Court has observed, that in criminal law, the degree of negligence has to be higher than that of the negligence enough to fashion liability for damages in civil law. The essential ingredients of mens rea cannot be excluded from consideration when the charge is in a criminal court consists of criminal negligence. So that is the observation. So now you are clear, or probably you will be clear now, what is the negligence in criminal case and negligence in civil case, that is for claiming damages under the law of tort. So rashness, criminal negligence itself have to be found out that the rashness was such a degree as to amount to taking hazard knowledge, knowing, and the hazard was of such a degree that injury was most likely to imminent, that is in criminal case. So but in civil case, that is a civil negligence, failure of due to negligence, dictionary meaning of negligence is failure of duty to take care. First, that duty, failure of duty to take care to the plaintiff, it means that there is a defendant has a legal duty. So mere moral, religious, or social duty, if somebody fails, that will not be treated as negligence. For an example, if X found Y was drowning in the river, X did not act, that will not be negligent. So there must be a legal duty of the defendant to the plaintiff. The plaintiff has to establish that the defendant owed to him a specific legal duty to care of who has made a breach. So there is no general rule defining such duty. What is there is no general rule what duty is there. It depends in each case whether that is the famous decision is the Donohue versus Stevenson. In Donohue versus Stevenson case, what happens? A purchased a bottle of ginger beer from a retailer, from the appellant, a lady friend. Some of the contents were poured, her friend consumed, and it was in an upper cubicle. And lastly, after consuming, she found there is a snail. So she suffered from some sickness. For that, damages was claimed under the law of tort. Because here, that is a duty that the House of Lords held, that because when a person is manufacturing beverage, etc., he should be extra careful that it is free from any foreign substance. So here, that's why that depends on the reasonable foreseeability of the injury. That foreseeability was lacking with that this ginger beer company. For that, this company was made liable to pay damages. So reasonable foreseeableness. An ordinary man, what is it? Was a duty to the plaintiff or not depends on the reasonable foreseeability of the injury to the plaintiff. So there must be a duty. If at the time of the act of omission, the defendant could reasonably foresee injury to the plaintiff, may not be under the any contract, etc. But if at the time of performing doing some act, if the defendant could have a reasonable foresee injury of the plaintiff, he owes a duty to prevent that injury, even to any third party. ड्यूटी टू टेक केयर इज द ड्यूटी टू अवॉइडिंग डूइंग और ओमिटिंग टू एनीथिंग और द डूइंग और ओमिटिंग टू व्हिच मे हैव अ रीजनेबल एंड प्रोबेबल कॉन्सिक्वेंस इंजरी टू अदर्स पॉसिबिलिटी देयर इफ माय एक्ट विल आई मस्ट व्हाइल डूइंग सम एक्ट आइदर ड्राइविंग माय मोटर व्हीकल और एक्टिंग एज इन माय प्रोफेशनल कंडक्ट एज अ डॉक्टर और इवन ए होटलियर सो आई मस्ट in every circumstances this I must that foresee I must keep in mind that my act will not cause any injury if there is reasonable foreseeability in that my act will cause injury then it will be treated that the I had a duty to the others and for that what that for my malfeasance that is misfeasance act not malfeasance for misfeasance act doing my act lawful act in a improper manner I am liable under the law of tort that is the general principle that is there must be a duty of take care that duty must be to the plaintiff there will be no liability if the injury not foreseeable if the injury is not foreseeable then the liability is not there so the Kates versus Mungini brothers The plaintiff, a lady visitor to a restaurant, was injured by the falling of a ceiling fan on her. The mason for the falling of the fan was a latent defect. The reason for falling of the fan was a latent defect. That was not the restaurant owner had not that smelt or had not reasonable foreseen. There was no foreseeability that the fan will fall. So in such case. Because there was lack of not foreseeable, the injury was not foreseeable. For that, the student owner will not be liable. So reasonable foreseeability does not mean remote possibility. Remote possibility is not there. Again, that is which will cause direct injury. For that, duty to guard against probabilities rather than the possibilities. Probably they are not possibilities. So this is reasonable breach of duty. Breach of duty means non-observant due care which is required to be taken in a particular situation. What is standard of care required? The standard is that of a reasonable man of an ordinary prudent man. If the defendant has acted like a reasonable prudent man, there is no negligence. There is no negligence. So here, if the defendant had acted as an ordinary prudent man while performing his act, then there will be no negligence. So this is the spillover of duty to take care. And third is that there must be actual injury, damage must be there. That third, three requirement. Third is, it is also necessary the defendant's breach of duty must cause actual damage to the plaintiff. The plaintiff has also to show that the damage thus caused is not too remote. That must be direct connection with the act of the defendant. So yesterday we discussed what is res ipsa locutor. Res ipsa locutor is a rule of evidence. What is it? As a general rule, he who files a suit, he must prove his case. Similarly, when a claim is made under the law of tort for act of negligence of somebody, the person who has sued, who has filed this suit claiming damages, he must prove that the defendant is negligent. If the incident itself, if the damage or the harm caused by the act is such a nature that it clearly proves the negligence of the defendant, in such case the res ipsa locutor principle will be applicable. So in such case, the initial burden of plaintiff that the burden of the plaintiff to prove that the defendant negligent is discharge. What it says, as a general rule, it is the plaintiff to prove that the defendant was negligent when action is brought for a negligent act. The initial burden of making out at least a prima facie case of negligence as against the defendant, that is, lies heavily on the plaintiff. The initial burden to prove that the defendant was negligent, that is on the plaintiff. But once this onus is discharged, this was that initial burden that the defendant discharged, it will be for the defendant to prove that the incident was the result of inevitable accident. In such case, the defendant must prove that he was not negligent, but it was an inevitable accident, or there is a contributor negligence on the part of the plaintiff. What is contributor negligence? There is a separate chapter, we will discuss it. Contributory negligence in the sense means the plaintiff himself has contributed. He has some amount of fault in that, for that act, for that harm. So in that is called contributor negligence. If the plaintiff is not able to prove negligence on the part of the defendant cannot be made liable. That is the general rule. But here, that is under the res ipsa loquitur, the principle is that by applying means the thing speaks of itself. Res ipsa loquitur means the thing speaks of itself. When the incident explains only one thing. When the accident or the incident expressed one thing, that is the accident could not ordinarily occur. Unless the defendant had been negligent, the law raises a presumption of negligence on the part of the defendant. That is res ipsa loquitur. The accident is of a such a nature that itself shows that it could not have happened. If the defendant was not negligent. In such case, the res ipsa loquitur principle will be applicable. Thereby, the plaintiff will not be asked to prove that the defendant is negligent. The defendant can, however, avoid his liability by showing that either inevitable accident or the plaintiff had contributed negligence. So, in those cases, that is res ipsa loquitur. What is res ipsa loquitur? The thing is, suppose there is a snapping of electric wire, live electric wire, that a person came in contact with that electric wire and died. The accident itself shows that the defendant electricity company was negligent in proper maintenance of the electric wire. So here that in such case, the res ipsa loquitur principle will be applicable. And in such case, the plaintiff will not be required to prove that the defendant was negligent. To avoid his liability, the defendant, that is electricity company, may prove either it was an accident or there is a contributor negligence. Contributor negligence is that the plaintiff himself contributed something. The himself have caught the wire, or plaintiff himself climbed the electric pole. There was a contributor negligence. So, or the defendant was taking unauthorized electricity from that wire, thereby the wire was snapped. So this is called contributory negligence. So that is this res ipsa loquitur principle will be applicable in such case. That is res ipsa loquitur. Then a very debatable question is, in a medical negligence. Most of the time, medical negligence, for that, doctors are blamed for the death of a person. For that, the doctors are sued under the law of tort. So you should know what is medical negligence. Medical negligence or professional negligence. Medical is a professor. So in case of professor, suppose you can say res ipsa loquitur principle. No, that is not applicable. Because in case of a medical negligence, the plaintiff must show that the professional act performed by the doctor was complete negligence. So if the doctor had acted scissors are left in the body of the patient during operation, that will be treated as medical negligence. Then these conditions worsened and he died. So here that is medical negligence. So here that is also proof as Ripka's principle will be applicable. Suppose the plaintiff got herself operated for the removal of her uterus in the defendant's hospital. There was diagnosed by a cyst in the area of one of her ovaries. Due to the negligence of the hospitals who performed the operation, an abdominal pack was left in her abdomen. The abdominal pack was left. This same was removed by a second surgery, leaving foreign matters in the body during the operation was held to be a case of res ipsa locutor. In such case, if the res ipsa locutor will be applicable. That is called this. The act itself speaks the negligence of the, proves the negligence of the doctor. Similarly, the patient had undergone a sterilization operation after childbirth. A mop was left inside the abdomen. So here the res ipsa locutor principle will be applicable. So we must know in which case, if the act is such a nature that itself proves the negligence, that no further proof of negligence is required, that proves that the defendant apparently proved the negligence of the defendant, then the res ipsa locutor principle will be applicable. Similarly, in case of this Samar Baran Shah versus State of West Bengal, a 16-year-old boy who was standing in a queue for purchasing the ticket for a cricket test match was trampled by a crowd which caused a stampede there and was seriously injured. The Cricket Association of Bengal was found negligent in not taking proper any security from the state in view of the crowd. The state government has also failed to ensure adequate security of the people in the queue. So it was held to be a case of res ipsa locutor. What is res ipsa locutor? Various acts should be. Similarly, in the state of MP versus Asha Devi, a police vehicle carrying about 30 to 32 constables, while passing the culvert, dashed against the culvert, resulting in the death of 5 constables. The vehicle at the time was being driven at a speed of 30 kilometers per hour. That speed was considered to be excessive, and a presumption of negligence was raised, and res ipsa locutor principle will be applicable. Another, so Karnataka State Road Transport Corporation versus Krishnan. In an accident, 2 buses brushed each other in such a way that the left hand of 2 passengers traveling one of the bus were cut off below from the shoulder joint. It was held that the accident itself speaks volume. The accident itself speaks volume, many. About the negligence on the part of the drivers of both the vehicles. So the doctrine of res ipsa locutor will be applicable. This is very, very important thing. What is res ipsa locutor? You should know in which case the accident, the incident itself shows, itself speaks volume or speaks, shows, apparently shows the negligence of the defendant. Then in such case, the res ipsa locutor principle, what is res ipsa locutor? In Gangaram versus Kamalbai Komalabai, the front tire of a taxi burst, as a result of which the taxi left the road, went on its offside and turned somersault. 2 passengers traveling in the taxi got killed in the accident. The high speed of the car was apparent from the fact that the car had left drag mark, that is skid mark, nearly 20 feet. So this res ipsa locutor principle will be applicable. So in various case laws are there where res ipsa locutor principle will be applicable. The act itself speaks. The maxim of res ipsa locutor applies when the only interference from the fact is that the defendant is negligent. Accident could not have occurred but due to defendant's negligence. Only in such a situation res ipsa locutor principle will be applicable. So this rebuttal, can we presume the rule of res ipsa only shifts the burden, only it shifts the burden. If you say res ipsa locutor, only it shifts the burden that the defendant was not negligent to the defendant. that by when by applying res ipsa locutor principle, the defend that the plaintiff is discharged of the burden of proof that the defendant was negligent. Sometimes Norsuk, the branch of law, so it is whether Norsuk is a, if somebody that is psychological pain is caused, so Norsuk is caused. So in such case, whether a person can claim damages, there are different case laws, but in one that is in Wilkinson versus Downton case, the defendant was held liable when the plaintiff suffered of Norsuk and got seriously on being told falsely by UFA practical joke by the defendant that her husband had broken both of his legs in an accident. Sometimes Norsuk. This branch of law is that is a recent origin. Whether for Norsuk a person will claim damages or not, it provides relief when a person may get physical injury, not by impact. Always physically, for physical injury under the law of tort, a person is entitled for damages. But in certain cases, that is, a person is also entitled for damages for Norsuk. The thought that an action could not be sustained unless there was a physical impact or something akin to it, that is, now it has been developed. Not long after the above stated decision, that is, we find there are also decisions where a plaintiff can claim damages for Norsuk. The defendant's husband negligently drove a horse van into a public house, and the plaintiff, a pregnant woman who was standing there behind the bar, although not physically injured, suffered a Norsuk as a result, or she gave birth to a premature child and a stillborn child. So the defendant were liable for the Norsuk. So this is that is similarly in Dudley versus Camille Inlet. The plaintiff, the driver of a crane, suffered Norsuk when he saw that the breaking of a rope of the crane, its load fell into the hole of a ship when some men were at work. The rope had broken due to the negligence of the defendant. Because of negligent act of the somebody, some Norsuk is caused. For that also, a person can claim damages. That is, in nutshell, we discuss about the negligence. In the next class, we'll discuss what is medical and professional negligence in detail. Thank you.